Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Will to Love group and is part of the Education in Love series. In the My Will to Love presentation, Jesus discusses the three possible directions to develop your will and how two of these directions continue to be harmful. Reminds us of the specific ways to develop our will to love, and challenges us to consider what is the true state of our will right now. Recorded on the 12th of March 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Okay. Well, here we are, the last day. Yippee! And the focus of the last day basically is to firstly remind you of what we've taught you up until now mostly, but also to focus on this question of, like, in the question of developing my will to love, obviously what we want to do is examine my personal will to love, just what's that looking like, and what am I going to need to do if I'm going to need to develop this will to love. Now, yesterday we covered a lot of material about pain versus pleasure and how many of us are still making decisions based around our pain rather than making decisions based on love or truth. And this is a big issue involved in this particular discussion as well. But what we would like to do this morning is focus your attention specifically now on your will to love rather than your will to do a whole heap of other things. So we would like to focus your attention on that. Now, with regard to developing or growing my will, there's really three things I can do with regard to growing a will. The first thing that I can do is nothing. Right? So in other words, we've come along to the session, spent 30 hours here, had a bit of a holiday, gone away, and decided, well, no, I don't want to do anything to grow my will to love. Now, what's going to be the results of that? Well, all the sin that's inside of oneself will remain there. So sin remains. Oops, I might use a different colour there. So sin remains. Now, if sin remains, what else remains? Pain obviously will remain. And because sin remains, obviously sin will continue to trigger our future actions. So in other words, all of our future actions will be specifically the same probably actions that I've been taking in the past. So the sin is probably, because it remains within me, is probably going to beget more sin, actually. So the reality is not only does sin remains, but that probably sin will also grow, which will also mean that pain grows. And because we've got now this long-term situation, it's pain remains and suffering appears as well, doesn't it? Suffering appears. So doing nothing doesn't, although, you know, from a change perspective, it may seem like an attractive option, the reality is it's not that attractive, is it? So doing nothing doesn't really work very well. And many of you have tried doing nothing and found that it doesn't work very well. So that's an experiment that many of you have also already tried. So develop, not growing my will to love does those things. Now, I could also grow my will to sin, couldn't I? That's another action I can take. So grow will to sin. In other words, I'm choosing to sin more and I know that I'm doing it. Right? So I'm growing my will to sin. What's the outcome there? Well, we can see that not only does the old sin remain, therefore the old pain remains, but now we're actually creating new sin purposefully by choice, which was bound to have extra painful effects, is it not? and more suffering. So it actually means that suffering and pain and suffering will grow. I will continue to break God's laws and probably in this place choose to break more of them. Now remember we also said yesterday that it's like with sin, it's like you do it the first time and that's when usually your soul's the most sensitive to the choice that's being made. And so you feel a bit of guilt maybe, a bit of conscience, pang of conscience and so forth when you sin. But the trouble is that each sin that you engage desensitizes you to the sin itself. So I also will have this desensitization process. Sensitization process, which will occur in my soul, where I become more and more insensitive or to the sin itself, and therefore more highly likely to engage it further. All right? And this can be like a snowballing effect with regard to sin, in that we're then willing to commit larger and larger sins, all the while desensitizing our soul to the effects of such sin. Right? And the problem with that is that in the desensitization process, we end up with sort of like it's very self-destructive, but it also harms other people quite a lot as well. And we see this happening all the time, where people desensitize themselves to sin and then choose to do something even worse, and then something even worse, and then something even worse again. And eventually, it's the road and path to self-destruction in the end. Graham, you'd like to ask? Thanks, Christian.
Would an example of that be where you just give up with respect to your addictions and go, oh, I've been having all this trouble with my addictions and I've tried to do this and I've tried to do that and I've been using my willpower and all that sort of thing, and you just give up and go, oh, I can't do it anymore. You know, like people that might leave this path and just give up, you know?
Yeah, so you basically you surrender to the addiction.
Yeah.
Rather than actually wanting or having or developing a will to fight through the addiction and work your way through growth instead.
Yeah.
It happens frequently. We see generally people engage it in two ways. That the way that you mentioned is the first way, which is a real. It's like a. I would classify it as a passive aggressive anger about the whole process, basically, where I just say, ah, blow it all. I might as well just sin on earth and pay the penalty later on. Not understanding the depth of the penalty, also not understanding the pain that's going to have to be gone through later on, but also feeling like, you know, just angry about having to do anything about it anyway, type of thing, without actually experiencing the anger of it, right? You know, we just sort of desensitize ourselves to that, even, or into this passive aggression where we just go, well, no, blow it all, I'm just not going to bother, type of thing. So that's one way of addressing it. The other way of addressing it is that people get their addiction triggered and it inflames their rage in a moment, and before they know it, in that rage, they go and do a whole heap of very unloving things which severely degrade their soul from that point in their anger. And we observe that occur quite frequently as well. So, and many of my friends in the first century engaged that process, and that's why many of them are still in the hells today, because they engage this process of just becoming enraged and never getting out of their rage.
Like, it's hard to imagine anybody would say, oh, I'm going to go out and do loads of sin now. You know, it's like it's going to be you're not really aware of what you're doing.
Correct, because we haven't had an awakening to sin. So remember, the awakening process is essential to know what sin is. Because we haven't had an awakening to sin, we have the world's definition of sin, which basically is, you know, loving acts from the world's perspective is sin from God's perspective. So we even oftentimes think we're doing the right thing, and justify the process of doing the right thing, all the while creating more sin and therefore more pain and suffering for ourselves and others. And at some point we need to have this awakening process needs to occur. Now, you can't repent without awakening either. So you must first have an awakening to sin before repentance can be engaged. And this is one of our problems too with regard to the use of our will. If we don't use our will to awaken to sin, to be aware of what a sin is, then we'll never use our will to repent and therefore never be able to engage some of God's higher laws in terms of our progression. Yeah. Yep. So he says so.
Jesus, I actually knew when I actually made my first decision to sin, and I was only about 18, I knew it was wrong, but I didn't feel that I had any... my false belief is that I'm excluded from any possible happiness in a relationship.
Yeah.
And I've been so angry about that because of that false belief that I then, every time I did it, I knew I was doing it, but I was so angry because it was like, I'm either going to be a nun.
Yeah.
And...
So anger does drive a lot of our desire for sin. It does. We just get angry, and instead of feeling angry and feeling what the anger is about, and remember, angry generally is about our addictive demand not being met, right? And then the anger is our choice to not look at the addictive demand that we have and instead try to act it out or try to get that thing met through our environment. And I would also suggest to you, Cess, that while that might have been the first time you recognised that you made a choice to sin, most people have made choices to sin from the time they're 3, 4, 5 years of age, actually, and have made purposeful choices knowing that the outcome is not good. Right. You often see it in a 3-year-old child when they, you know, go up to another child and hit them. They know they're doing the wrong thing frequently, but they still feel the need to do it because it satisfies the addiction, and the parents haven't taught them any differently, of course, because the parents are too busy satisfying addictions as well. So they're modelling to the child to satisfy addiction. So the reality is most of us have already made choices to sin by the time we're 5, not by the time we're 18.
But I mean, I'm talking about what I consider heinous sins, or heinous, however you say it,
serious sin, yeah.
Yeah, well... that I had previously said, this is one thing I will never do.
Yeah.
Like betray another woman.
Yeah.
Go behind her back.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's, you know, again, what I've said is true though, isn't it? The anger itself driving the behaviour. Yep. So this desensitization process is often driven by the two factors. One is the fact that we're not aware of what really sin is, so we've not yet had an awakening to it. But also the other thing is frequently we know that it's a sin, but we're actually angry about it and we just want to engage it anyway. Right? So many women who have abortions feel that, actually. You know, they consider it, they feel, oh, it's not right, it doesn't feel right to me. You know, they feel that, but then they desensitise that emotional response because the justification is higher than the emotional response is affecting them. So, you know, this is the process of growing our will to sin. We start off slow, but unfortunately, we have a tendency to just keep on engaging to such a point that we are not even aware of what a big sin is anymore. Right, so there's plenty of people in that condition. Can I come down to Cavill? Thanks.
When you're speaking of abortions, even considering an abortion but is a sin...
Well, yes, it is, because it's driven by emotions that are out of harmony with love, obviously. Otherwise, you would never consider it. Mm-hmm. So it's the emotions that remain in the soul that are the sins. And, of course, those emotions are the pre they're the precursor to making a further decision that's quite large, out of harmony with love. So for example, in the case of abortion, it could be like, I've engaged sexually with this guy, right? If you're a woman, you've engaged sexually with this guy, but you don't think he's marriage material, and you don't really think that you love him, but you've engaged sexually for some, you know, addictive reason. Now that in itself is already a sin, engaged by for some other reason, right? And now all of a sudden you've gotten pregnant, right? So the pregnancy is the result of the previously engaged sin. Do you understand?
Yes.
And then we go, oh no, I'm pregnant, and I'm pregnant to this guy I don't really love, or no, I can't rely on him. He's not going to be safe and secure for me to be with in the long term. So I can't imagine, or it could be a simple feeling of, I can't cope now. You know, I've been having sex, but I can't cope with the results of sex. Do you see what I'm saying? So we now make another decision that we rub out the life we've created, right? And we have all these justifications for that. And this is what I mean, is that quite often, like, it's not just a simple matter. And by the way, this also applies to acts of goodness. Usually there's a build-up in both directions. So, for example, with an act of goodness, you might have had a life of being harmed yourself, and then all of a sudden you start wanting to address those particular things, and you feel like you want to help others to do those particular things and so forth, and the life of goodness slowly builds. And the life of self-destruction, the life of sin, also slowly degrades in the same manner, based on choices and decisions, you see. So there's usually never an act of goodness without there being precursor acts of goodness that have led to that condition. And there's usually also never a major act of sin that hasn't had a whole series of precursor acts that have led to that particular decision. Does that make sense? And this is what we talked about yesterday with you. Remember when we talked about either growing our will to love or growing our will to sin? It's a small step at a time, usually, that we're engaged in one or the other directions that cause us to do either of those two things. Right, so you can make small steps now, even just in awareness, that can grow your will to love. Or you can make small steps now through your anger or other kinds of resistances to grow your will to sin. Yeah, so it's very rare that people are actually put in life-threatening situations and then they sin. Usually it's been a long established pattern of their life of slowly degrading their condition of integrity and morality before they have actually engaged those particular things. So this is where we need to say, in the Robert James Lee's material, Afrar often says that, and he says in a number of locations, but one in particular I was thinking of, I think it's in the Life Elysian, he says that, you know, major impact of life choices fall on decisions that turn on a diamond point. You know, just like a tiny little switch in gear, a tiny little justification leads to another tiny little justification, another tiny little justification. And he was referring to the choices his father made, right, while he was on earth, how he made a tiny little justification here, a tiny little justification there, another justification here, all unloving justifications, slowly leading him into the hells. So by the time he arrives in the spirit world, he's now in the hells, regretting the fact that he made all these tiny little decisions to get him there. So the reality also is that the majority of people have a sensitivity to their big sins, but they have very little sensitivity to the things that led them to the big sin. Right. Now, another example of that you've heard of is that when we channeled Robert James Lee's. Remember, myself and Mary did that. It's an audio recording on our website. And if you listen to that recording, he said the biggest problems he had to face in the spirit world after he passed, and the main thing that caused him to remain, you know, in a place in the hills before he progressed, was because he chose to ignore the things that he was choosing to ignore and justifying ignoring. They were the biggest problems that he had to face. And he didn't, the things that he thought were big, he had already faced to a degree internally, and therefore already paid some of the penalty, right? But the things that he thought were nothing, they in fact were the things that impeded his progress the most. And it's the little nothings, if you can call them that, that lead us down a road to sin. Decision, little decision here, little decision there, and so forth. Many of you do it every day without even considering, you know, the little thing that just happened that led you down a path where a greater sin then could be accomplished and also contemplated. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you.
If we go to Karen, thanks. And across over there too, thanks. Leave your hand up, thanks. Thanks, Pam. Karen.
Yesterday you said something. I understood that what you were saying was that on any given day, you and Mary will look at whatever issue is the biggest for you on that day.
Mm-hmm.
And going on from what you said about the tiny little things.
No, I was referring to the... You do this quite frequently, Karen. Is you take something I've previously said and then apply it to a new conversation which has no bearing on the conversation. And this is because you're too much in your intellect without feeling what I'm actually trying to say to you. Yesterday we were speaking specifically about the things that have an effect on our life and a large effect on our life. Those things are the things we're most emotionally sensitive to. So it makes sense to address those particular things. But it's that doesn't change the fact that it's the things that we're desensitized to that are going to be the hardest to change. Right? That's why it's a growing process. It's the things that you're currently desensitized to completely that are going to be the hardest things for you to change, without a doubt.
I was thinking of looking at big things in my life, but then, for example, last night some tiny little thing happened, and I often, you know, go off in a different direction then.
Yep. So what's the question?
Well, I think there's a big issue, and then there's, like, it's almost every day, there's another one that seems to be different, and it's, am I being distracted from the big issue, or?
Well, that's something for you to determine, isn't it? Like I said to you yesterday, we're wily characters, you know, we're slippery creatures,
right.
And when you start, if you find that every time you start confronting an issue that you know is large emotionally to confront, and then you find 10 minutes later you're off on another subject, or you find the day later you're off on another subject, that it probably means that you're avoiding the first one, doesn't it? But this is something you need to work out for yourself.
Okay.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yes,
it's like, if we take personal responsibility for our decisions and behaviour, we will be able to work out whether we're just making something up to distract us from the previous thing, or whether we have a growing awareness of different things. Do you see? There's
right.
a difference between those two places.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's really up to each individual. This is why the first 2 days of this presentations about analysing your own situation was so important, because you need to accurately analyse your own situation rather than just sort of making presumptions that you're not a wily character and you're not, you know, and you're not trying to get out of things and you just have new things coming up every day. And that's generally my feelings are, generally if we have new things coming up every day when the last thing wasn't dealt with, then there's a high indication there that we don't want to address any of those issues.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yep. And we were over, Pamela.
Yes, the religious idea of penance.
Can the guys see you? Yep, good.
If we sin, as long as we punish ourselves, then it's okay. That sort of idea.
Yeah, well, it's interesting too how we punish ourselves, isn't it, Pamela? Like, the reality is that it doesn't matter how much you punish yourself, God's still going to have God's law do the job, whatever the job is. So the law of compensation is still going to work. And in fact, punishing yourself is out of harmony with another law. So you're actually sinning again. So you sin, and then you punish yourself for the previous sin, not understanding that that hasn't paid the penalty of the previous sin. And on top of that, you've now created another one for which there will be a law that causes pain. To result for that of that self-punishment. So the whole religious concept of punishing yourself to avoid punishment from somebody else, which actually is not necessarily a religious concept, but a family-based concept. We wouldn't have a predisposition to that concept religiously unless we had a family who brought us up in that same way. Does that make sense? And this is a very common way that we have as children to try and avoid the punishment of parents. We realise very early in our age that in our life that if we choose to punish ourselves in agreement with our parents' punishment of us, then it's highly likely we will get away with our parents punishing us. Right? That doesn't work with God. Right? So give up the whole self-punishment and get into the actual reason why you did something is the most important thing to choose to do. Maxine?
With continuous sin, and someone like a man and a woman, they continue to sin throughout their life, they've got so many sins in them, and then they decide to have children, mm-hmm. that creates birth defects?
Well, yes. This is what the major creation of birth defects is, the multi-generational sin that's been imposed upon each generation. And this is the problem, is that we, at this stage, there's very little scientific investigation into the relationship between multi-generational emotional injuries and the genetic deformation of the human genome. And the reality is they do have a correlation. And it's very similar to what happens in your brain as well and the rest of your body as well. Different sins cause a predisposition of certain failures of certain organs in your body. And this is why you get things like, you know, sugar diabetes being genetic, you know, or highly genetic in the sense of if your mum has it, or your grandmother has it, then it's more highly likely you will have it. Those kind of genetic deformations that put a higher probability on a certain type of illness all come from emotions that have been chosen by the multi-generational, you know, history to sin in a certain way without there being an awakening to the sin. The reality is you can also reverse the process. So if you can remove the particular sin, and now the human genome, the genes, have got a way of recovery from those particular problems as well. So you can actually, might have a for example, a long strain of genetic deformation of, you know, the human genome with regard to, say, something like Down syndrome. And then within one or two generations, both generations address the emotions within themselves as to what causes that particular deformation, which obviously has come down a long line of people. And then they address that particular emotion, there's then no danger of there ever being that particular gene passed on to the next generation. So.
Yeah, I asked the question because my parents were very violent and toxic, and out of the 15 children that they had, there was a minimum of two of those children that had birth defects, and they weren't quite large. And I'm thinking, wow, how someone has, my father was in Second World War and he's murdered and raped and done a lot of terrible things.
Yeah.
And the 15 of us are not that bad, I thought, but...
Yeah. What I find quite remarkable is the human body's capability of sustaining quite large negative emotions in the soul without going into a place of self-destruction. You know, the reality is that by the time we've got genetic deformation, for example, of the gene, you know, things are already quite extreme with regard to the emotion that's driving those particular problems. So, and the same applies to any physical pains that we have. By the time we have physical pain that turns into some kind of chronic issue, it usually means we're in quite a large suppression of a particular problem for a long period of time. Does that make sense? So, for example, for myself, I was born with bowel issues, like with problems in my bowel. I had a part of my bowel removed when I was 2 years of age. So that is an indication that there was some genetic thing going on where the, you know, parents had a certain type of emotion with regard to worth. Both my parents have quite low worth. And as a result, There's obviously spirit attachments that have occurred. If you have that kind of sickness at that age, you've probably got a spirit attached to the particular area of your body as well. And all of those particular things could have been cured by my parents, but I've had to now address those particular issues. Now, I'm still not finished addressing those issues, so I've still got issues with my bowel, but I went through periods where I had terrible issues with my bowel, and it's slowly getting better as I deal with each new emotion. Does that make sense? So it just depends on what the emotion is and how it affects your body. But the thing we're trying to get at is that we don't realise that when we grow our will to sin, it's actually the small things that we decide to do out of harmony with love that we don't have an awakening to that cause our long-term self-destruction. It's very rarely the large things, because most of us don't choose large things without firstly having chosen, you know, hundreds of small things to reach that condition where we're willing to choose a large thing. Does that make sense? And this is what we need to come to understand, the slow degradation or the slow improvement of humankind is very much dependent upon each individual choice that is made, either in or out of harmony with love. If we go to Tara.
Is the, depending on the type of sin, does it damage your soul differently? Like you just get little, as I say to my kids, splatters of mud or big patties of mud.
So each emotion that is created by the sin that you've chosen does damage your soul differently and therefore damage your bodies differently. Yeah. Yep, definitely. That's why I said, so you remember yesterday, I said there is a direct pattern and correlation between two women who get breast cancer in their right breast or their left breast. There's a direct correlation between it being the left breast. There's the same emotion in both of those women. Does that make sense? Towards other women. And that's what caused the problem in the left breast. And so once there is enough scientific investigation on this planet, though obviously there's plenty of scientific investigation that's happened in the spirit world with regard to this issue, but once scientists open up to the concept, they'll be able to then trace the direct pattern between the emotion that the person is abusing out of harmony with love and the disease that they've created as a result of that abuse. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And once you see the correlation, now you have a cure. And the cure won't be a pharmaceutical cure. It'll be an emotional cure. A need to work through specific emotions in a certain way before you can actually cure the particular problem.
Yeah, yep. Thanks.
Yep. Marion, thank you.
I've got an example of the small things leading to a big thing, and it relates to my dog.
Can I stop the personal stories?
Oh, sorry.
Let's move on to someone else. Thank you. Thanks. Yep.
I'm just wondering quickly if you had a reference for that. You mentioned something in Afra's book about how he describes. Sorry.
Yeah, it was where he was talking about, I can't remember the actual chapters, but okay. It was where he was talking about his father. Remember in the, I think it's the second book where he had the opportunity to go back and talk to his father, and in the sense that he channeled to Robert James Lees, who was still on Earth, and Robert James Lees went and talked to his father for him. And in that passage, there's a whole heap of stuff about the choices and decisions that his father was making.
Great, thank you. Mm. That's the second book.
I think it's the second book, yeah. Yeah, thanks. Natalie, thanks.
I was just wondering, you know, we're talking about big sin, little sin, like from God's perspective, isn't it all just sin?
No, there are some sins that have a much wider impact and therefore much more serious than other sins, certainly. So, for example, the more I impact larger groups of people, the bigger the sin. And this is why becoming a teacher is a very dangerous thing if you're teaching the wrong thing, because you're impacting upon tens of thousands, potentially hundreds of thousands of people. So if you're actually teaching an error, you're actually placing yourself in quite serious danger of large sins, because you're affecting the lives of tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands or even millions of people.
So then does that mean that then the law of compensation, like the penalty, varies as well?
Of course, based on the seriousness.
You feel?
Definitely.
Yeah. Yep. Okay, thanks.
Definitely does. If we just continue with this though, can we? Because basically there is also the thing that happens in this process of growing the will to sin, in that we're basically entering a state of rebellion. Right, and this is what I notice is a worrying thing for many of you, in that you have a desperate desire to rebel against human law. And this is an indication that you probably also have a desperate desire to rebel against God's laws. Does that make sense? We don't understand, most people don't understand how much rebellion causes us to enter this state of wanting to sin or justifying our sin. So we need to be very careful of that. When I say rebellion, we're really, what we're doing is rebelling, having a rebellion with, against God's laws. And that never works out well when we're in that state of rebellion. So if you find in your own life that you do have a rebellion against human law, my suggestion is to really contemplate that, because it's most likely you also have a similar level of rebellion and anger towards God's laws. Yep. Okay, well, let's look at the third issue. Obviously, there's three parts to this, so let's continue with that. You're very focused on the negative this morning, you notice that. But anyway, let's look at we grow the will to become perfect. That's our third option. Now, obviously, to do that, we must first believe we can become perfect, which means we need to have faith that we can become perfect, that perfection is possible. Right? And then we need to take steps that will help us grow our will to become perfect. And perfection, real perfection, is really only available to us from with the connection with God. But the reality is, even if we don't have a connection with God, we can become the perfect natural human, like the same as a sixth year spirit would be. And if everybody on earth just even chose that, we would already have no war and very little suffering on the planet, just by choosing that. So we can grow the will to become perfect, either the perfect natural man or perfection from God's perspective, which is growing the will to live completely in harmony with love and truth, with no sin. Right. Now, these are the choices. So what I'm getting at here is these are the choices that are open to us. The results of the third choice, obviously, means that sin is removed. So all the old sin is removed. We sin no more. So therefore, the results of not sinning anymore will become, obviously, we'll have a reduction of our pain to the point that there's no pain, and a reduction of suffering until the point there is no suffering. And obviously, we'll also have a large impact upon our choice. We have a large impact upon somebody else's choice. So we may even finish up influencing or inspiring other people to make the same decision as well, which then has a subsequent benefit as well, both in our lives and theirs. So that are the three choices that we have available to us, really, when it comes to gaining our education in love. Unless we use our will to love, you can see that we have no hope of getting an education, really. Remember, this now links us back to the very first talk I gave on the Saturday you arrived. In that the majority of us is thinking, through my own effort, I've got to be loving. Not understanding, actually, that all I've got to do through my own effort is to allow God to communicate with me, and allow God to share God's love with me, and allow God to share God's truth with me. That's really all I have to do. And that will cause me, if I respond to that, it will cause me to become loving. it will mean that I'm now educated in love if I can allow the higher source to communicate with me. Now, the whole point of this week has been to help you see how the choices you're making are stopping you from receiving communication from God and stopping you from receiving love from God. Can you see that's why that's been our focus? Because without receiving love from God and without receiving the truth from God, we will never get an education in love. Basically, we'll be consigned to the place we are in, or the place where humanity is in. And this is basically the truth that's now in front of us, is that we can choose to do nothing about that, nothing about our connection with God, and in the end, this will be the result. But also, the bigger problem is that we will not know what love is. We will still retain the world definition of love, won't we? We won't know what love is. We'll just believe we know what love is. That's all we'll do in that place. This place here, we're actually saying a similar thing, but it's even a bit worse. It's saying, no, there's no such thing as love, actually, and I can continue to do one thing bad after another thing bad. Even things that the world thinks is bad, I can continue to do them with impunity. So this is another problem. Obviously, we're not going to get an education in love from God if we do that. So this is the only option for getting an education in love from God. This is really our only option. The other options are, you know, I would call it the imagination of our free will decisions, but they're not really very wise decisions. You know, this is one of the issues I feel with free will, is that at the end of the day, and I'm not saying there's an issue with God's gift of free will because it's beautiful, but at the end of the day, we have free will to make choices and decisions, and if we believe that we can continue to make decisions that break laws, and we choose to retain that particular decision-making process, then obviously our life's not going to pan out too well. Even though we're fooling ourselves that we've got some level of control over our life, the reality is God's laws are going to have a large amount of control over what happens to our life in that particular regard. If you think of God's laws as a framework, every time you step out of the framework, you are opening yourself up to more pain and suffering, right? So you can use your will to step out of that framework if you want, but in the end, the framework is imposed upon you, like all of us are governed by it, so pain and suffering will result by the choice. And we at some point need to see that. We're happy to see that, as we've discussed this week. We're happy to see it with physical things, you know, like gravity, aerodynamics and all those kind of things. We're happy to see it with those things. But when it comes to our emotional choices and our choice to sin, we are not happy to make a correlation between our choices and decisions and pain and suffering. And this is what needs to change. So unless we do that, an education is impossible from God's perspective. God can't educate you. And then you'll be basically at the whim of the environment you're living in as to how much education you'll receive. Right? Because God can't do it anymore. If we're not open to receiving education from God, then God can't educate us. And then the only option is after that is that we're educated by the world. That's really the only option. And what has the world already got? Pain and suffering. So highly likely we will end up in the same place of pain and suffering. Can you see? It gets down to the fact that if you want to be educated in love, and you really want that, and you really have an aspiration for that, then at some point you're going to have to open yourself up to the getting this education from a higher source, getting the education from God. Because it's going to be very hard for you to get an education in love otherwise. Yeah. Okay. Is there any questions about that? Amber, thank you.
When you said that we could get to a perfected state, did you say without God?
You can get to the perfect natural man or woman without God, yes. You can.
And that would just...
That's not God's definition of perfection, though.
No.
But you'd be perfect in the way that you express your love to others. So if we all got into that state, wars would cease.
And would that just be getting rid of old sin and feeling emotions, basically?
Yeah, it'd be going through the law of compensatory process, yeah, without other laws, without God's higher laws.
So it would be pretty much the same as this path, but you just wouldn't connect with God, is that...?
No, it's not the same as this path.
Okay.
So don't think it is the same as this path. This path involves repentance and forgiveness, right? And repentance, forgiveness engage God's higher laws, which are very much different to the law of compensation. The reality is the majority of you have already been living with the law of compensation. That's the reality. So what you think is the path is not path. The path is engaging the laws of repentance and forgiveness. That's the path. Most of you are not ready to engage those processes yet because you've not even developed your will to even love yet. At this stage, remember we said the majority of you are driven by pain. So the decisions you're making are based upon pain. So when you feel like you're in more pain, then you make a change. Well, a person who's driven by God's higher laws doesn't do that. A person who's driven by God's higher laws only makes the choice based on love. So if you have a choice of going through the law of compensation and the law of repentance, you would choose a law of repentance. Right? But these are things we need to discuss with you further on, aren't they? Because first we need to even have a will to love before we'll even do any of that. You see?
Cool. Thank you.
So that's why we've spent a lot of this time this week just on focusing on the will, because you will not engage, you won't even want to understand God's higher laws unless you have a will to love and see the necessity of getting an education in love from God rather than from the world. So the way that almost everybody progresses in the spirit world is the way of to the perfect natural man, if you like, or woman. And that particular way ends in the sixth dimension of the spirit world, the sixth sphere, and that particular way does not need God, that needs the law of compensation, will grind its way through all of your sin until you realize that you don't sin anymore and until you realize that you've forgotten all of your past sin from an emotional perspective. That's what the law of compensation does. That's the law that the majority of you are engaging. That's why we need to have a discussion about understanding God's laws. Because if you understood truly the power of the higher laws, you wouldn't engage that law anymore. You'd engage a whole series of other laws which all have major positive benefits to your life and also open you up to receiving communication, truth and love from God. Right, so this is you've got to remember that this is just the beginning of your education this week. But in particular, it's about your will. This is where we need to at some stage make this choice. Are we going to use my will to love? That's the choice that is before me. And then how to do that will become clear over the subsequent presentations we do. But at this stage, we need to make just even the choice. Do I want to or don't I? Like, let's not waste each other's time here. Let's just see whether you really want to or not. And if you're concerned that you don't really want to, but you would like to want to, you can change that. We've already showed you yesterday how to change that. All right, so, you know, we can change the aspiration so that we have a will to love even. We can do that. But will you is the question. What will you decide? That's the real question, isn't it? Yeah. If we go to Alex and then Yvonne.
It's just a question about repentance. Last week I realised something I did 20 years ago where I really hurt someone.
Yeah.
And... it was the first time where I kind of felt the effect of what happened and what I did, and I just felt quite remorseful about it.
Yeah.
And I even cried about it. How do I involve God in that?
Well, there's a reason why you did it, Alex. So most, what happens for most of us, and we will talk a lot about repentance later, right? Because it's a major law that you need to understand. But what happens for most of us, we think we're repentant when we're sorry for a previous act. But we're only ever going to be fully repentant once we remove from ourselves the reason why we took the act, which I said to you just earlier, that is a series of decisions that were made before the act was taken. A series of decisions, a series of degradation that occurred before the unloving act was taken. And a truly repentant person, right, is willing to go to that place of finding all the reasons why they did it. Right.
I actually saw that there was it was because of fear that I did it.
No, it wasn't because of fear.
Okay.
Keep thinking. If it wasn't because of fear, what was it?
I'm not sure at this point.
Fear is not an excuse. Fear is not a justification. It's not because of fear. So what is it? Remember, we've talked about that 2 days ago. Like, fear is not an excuse. Fear is not a justification. Fear is not the problem. Right? It's what we do with our fear that's the problem. Right? You say it's fear, but it's not fear that's the problem.
No, I suppressed my fear.
Why? So there was a choice.
I was afraid of being hurt.
So you, yeah, but that's not the reason why you hurt somebody else. Like, I can be afraid of being hurt and still not hurt you.
Yeah.
See, this is what I'm saying, is a person who's truly repentant knows why they did it. And you don't know why you did it, so you're not truly repentant.
Okay.
You follow?
Yeah.
Yeah, a person who's truly repentant knows why they did something. Knows the exact reason, the exact choices, the exact decisions that have led to that particular decision that was made. They know what it was. And if you don't know, then you're not repentant. You're just sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry does very little, actually. Repentance is a turning around process, a change that occurs within the soul. Sorry doesn't make a change in the soul, because sorry doesn't address the reasons why the action was taken. You follow?
Mm.
So this is what we'll share with you in the understanding.
Yeah, I'd love to have, like, you know, steps of, like, all the things that are needed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you know, it's very important to see that there's a lot of future education that is dependent upon this one decision that you need to make now, and that is, do I really want to become more loving, or don't I? What am I? Let's be honest with myself here. That's the decision I'm asking you to make now. For many of you, you've not yet made that decision. You think you have, but you haven't, because you keep making choices out of harmony with love, which is an indication that you haven't made the decision. Right? So what we're trying to present with you in this first presentation is, let's get real about our real desire to love or not. Let's get real about it. Like, let's really be honest about it. What is it I really want to do? Do I want to grow my aspiration to love, or don't I? So what I'm recommending to you guys now is saying, okay, you have a choice in front of you. Are you going to grow your aspiration to love by doing all those things we suggested the last few days to you? You know, by looking at thoughts, words, actions, and all these other things, the little decisions and choices you make each day to grow an aspiration inside of you to be more loving? Or are you just going to keep ignoring the issue of your using your will and just let other people ride over your will, let spirits control your will, and all of those kind of things? So many of you have this problem of letting spirits control your will, right? Alex, you're one of those. When I first met you, you were totally gone with spirits, right? Letting them control your will. So this is a big problem for you and Monique. You're both in this state of letting other people control your will a lot, thinking that it's your will, when actually, no, you're just connecting with other people. So this is what the decision I feel each need to face now. And the decision is, am I going to deal with this issue of having an aspiration to use my will to love or not? Am I really going to do it? Yvonne, you had a...
Yeah, so if I choose to grow my will,
yep.
Okay, and the sin's removed and the sin's no more, but there's got to be some good stuff. Can you just describe really briefly what it's going to be like?
Well, that, there's a whole section in two sessions' time which I'll be describing. Okay. we spend a whole hour on that. Yeah, yep. If we come to Barbara, thank you.
Okay, I'm not sure if I have a lot of nice, lovely spirits around me that mm-hmm. want me to get this, but as I'm reviewing my unloving, really, thoughts over the past couple days, it does feel painful. And yep. oftentimes I can feel, if I really spend some time with it, feel where it came from.
Yeah.
And if I just keep doing that, God will just keep educating me and I can continue to grow my will.
Yeah, well, you're having the beginning process of what I would classify as an awakening. Like, the very before you can repent for anything, you first need to have an awakening to what you need to repent about. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And majority of you yet to awaken to hardly anything that you need to repent about. So of course you're not going to repent unless that awakening occurs. So having the awakening is a very important process. Now, you have a lot of spirit, all of you have a lot of spirit help, positive spirit help, to help you have an awakening. On top of that, the laws are all governed to help you have an awakening. All of God's laws are helping you to have an awakening. But God's love does not cause the awakening. God's love flows into you after the awakening and the repentance has occurred. Do you follow? So this is what we need to understand, that the awakening is my decision, my choice. The awakening is something I need to decide to do for myself. And that process can be assisted by people who inspire you, by spirits who will try to help you face up to your life, by casting your mind back over your life and seeing what's happened and choices, decisions you've made in your life, by trying to become aware of the things you're not aware of and praying about those particular things. The things you're aware of are not so much of a problem as the things that you're not aware of. So for example, just give you a brief example. Most of you would say that if I had murdered somebody, that's a major sin, right? But most of you would not say that if I'm in terror, if I'm terror all the time, that it's a major sin. Right? Now, from God's perspective, the terror is what causes war. So therefore, the murder of millions of people is caused by the terror. So we're, by having the terror within, we're participants in every war that's ever occurred. So is that a major sin? Of course it is. So the problem is, for the majority of us, is we do not have God's perspective on what is a major sin and what is not. We only have the world's perspective on what is bad thing and what is not, right? And that's not the same as God's. It's just not the same as God. So what God's trying to help you do is having an awakening to his definition of sin, and your spirit friends are trying to help you do the same, have an awakening to God's definition of sin. God's laws are already structured to help you have an awakening to God's version of what sin is, you know, the real truth about sin. And we're just a lot of times in deep resistance to every one of those people helping us to have the awakening. But the awakening, we certainly need help from other people to have awakening. But one major thing that will help us as well in that process is to want to have an awakening, to have an aspiration to have an awakening, right? Without that aspiration, it's highly unlikely we'll have the awakening we need to have to sin. You follow? And that's a part of the steps of developing my will to love. That's one of the things that we'll definitely choose to do if I really want to become loving. So it's wonderful that the awakening begins. Now it's a matter of going, okay, what am I going to do with this awakening? Well, that's what we want to present with you over the coming sessions, as to how you actually handle what this awakening process that's now occurring to the things that have happened. And when I say the things that have happened, it's not just the things that have happened, it's the things that I do every single moment of every single day. Frequently I'm engaging sin in that moment. And frequently I think I'm not, you know? Frequently I think I'm not. There's many people who come up to myself and give me a gift, right? And in that moment they're engaging a sin and they don't know it. Right? Because it's driven by an addiction they have to do. So therefore they're engaging a sin. Right? and they don't even realize it. It's those kind of things that cause most of the problems, because it's the things you don't know that are the hardest to recognize, and therefore the hardest to have an awakening to, and therefore the hardest to repent for. You see? It's the big thing. The big things are generally not as difficult to have these kind of awakenings to. You know? But the little things, I've seen people go on, you know, I've seen people deal with, for example, the fact that they murdered somebody in 5 years, emotionally dealt with it, and then taken 200 years to deal with their addiction. Isn't that interesting? They engaged God's process with the murder, but with all the other things they didn't want to see, they didn't engage God's process, so the law of compensation had to grind its way through all of it. It took them hundreds of years. Right? So frequently the things that we know about are not as difficult to address as the things we don't know about. Right? And therefore refuse to believe. So I can give you many examples of that, but here's a very obvious example. If I placed most of us in, if we had been brought up, say, in the Middle East at this point in time, and particularly in one of the countries like Iran or something like that, that is still got a lot of progression to make with regard to equality between the sexes, right? The majority of you women would view yourself as lesser beings, and you wouldn't even be able to be present in this audience, actually. Right? You wouldn't be allowed to be taught with men under these circumstances. And the majority of men would believe that's the right thing. Now, if you're a man in that location, brought up all of your life from the time you're a little child to believe that you're better than women and you're more important than women, that God has put you in authority over women, how hard do you think that's going to be when you're an adult to actually work your way through it? Because you'll have firmly entrenched inside of your belief systems that it's just the right thing, won't you? And it's going to take a lot of self-reflection to work through the issue if you already believe that it's just right. Now, this was the same attitude that many Christians had towards black people in the USA, you know, 100 years ago when slavery was occurring, right? There was this biblical justification for slavery, which came from, you know, one of Noah's sons having committed a sin that was so bad that the rest of the generations would be black and that'd all be bad, and therefore the slaves of others. And that particular biblical justification meant that these so-called Christians, people who went to church, were willing to murder their own slaves, rape their own slaves, and so forth, right? And they felt fully justified taking all of those actions. So there's extreme actions taken with full justification, full self-righteousness, a belief that you're right. It's the things that you believe you're right with but are wrong from God's perspective that you are going to find the most difficult to address. Make sense? Yeah. So it's great the awakening's occurred there, Barb, the beginning of the awakening process, but of course we need to engage the process of true repentance, which will work its wonders on our soul.
Thank you.
Yep. If we come down to Jenny.
Over the last couple of days, I've been doing life review, as you've indicated to me before, a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And I've come to the realization that I cannot remember a time when I wasn't angry or I didn't have an angry response.
Yep.
And then I look back at my parents' life, both my mother separately and my father separately, and they were both profoundly angry individuals.
Mm-hmm.
And my grandparents on both sides, I've looked at that and their responses to things were angry.
So this is why you don't see a problem with anger?
No, I haven't seen a problem with anger.
Hmm.
My question is then, I have come to decide that to start on my anger, it doesn't work if I just go and have a bash and start to express anger.
What's the question, Jenny?
The question is I feel I need to start with those people immediately around me and begin the repentance process right now, who I'm affecting with my anger. Do you feel that that's the right way?
Can you see what you're doing?
No.
What have you just done? You've put your decision in my hands.
Oh.
That's you giving away your will. What if I said, no, that's not the right thing? What would you do then?
I'd reassess it. I definitely would reassess it.
Yeah.
And I would think that you were right.
I know you would.
Because you're in a greater space. I know you are in a greater space of love.
It's not that. You want me to reassure you here, which is an addiction. So you're already engaged in an act of unloving behaviour by feeding one of your addictions, which is the addiction for reassurance from a man, right? So you're already engaged in the unloving behaviour right now, right at this moment,
wow,
asking the question.
Wow. Okay.
This is what I notice you're doing. As a group, you do this frequently. You're engaging the very addiction, being unloving, while you're asking about how can I be more loving. So I don't have too much confidence in your process if you're willing to do that. Can you see what I'm saying to you? Can you see you're engaging in an addiction?
No.
No, you can't.
I feel in my
Because you want this addiction met by men and by me all the time.
The feeling inside of me is that I genuinely want an answer from you. But
why?
That's the addiction, isn't it?
That's the addiction. You're desperate for an answer from me. That's the addiction. You're not asking yourself why you need it. You're not. And unfortunately, you're also placing yourself in a position where I now have power over you. You're doing that. So if you do that with me, you're undoubtedly doing it with other people.
I do it with other people. You're right.
You're just fortunate I don't want to have power over you. Otherwise, I'd have complete power over your life. If I wanted to have power over your life, I'd have complete power over your life, Jen. Because you give away your will like this all the time. Right? This is what I notice. You give away your will, and on top of that, you feed the addiction, and then you ask me a question about what's loving. Without any self-reflection about what you're actually doing in that moment, that's unloving, firstly to you by giving away your will, secondly to me by wanting me to feed your addiction. Right? And this is what I notice the majority, majority are doing this, exactly this thing. It's like the very questions you're asking me are feeding your addictions. Why are you doing this? It's like an unloving behavior that you're engaging, wanting me to satisfy an addiction. I can't do this with you guys anymore. Like, I can't feed your addictions like this anymore. This is what I'm saying to you is that you've got to be a lot more self-reflective about what's actually going on in the moment. The very moment, the law of attraction is a wonderful thing, right? Because the very moment it happens, which is pretty much all the time, we have an opportunity to learn something, right? But you're actually engaging in an attraction because you put up your hand. I said, Jen, right? There's an attraction that was established. And then away you go with the addiction. The exact addiction I've told you about 100 times before. And you're still feeding it. And you don't want to change that. All right? So you erase a question about an addiction, which is about anger, your addiction to anger, while at the same time feeding another addiction. This is what we do. It's the ones we don't know. They're the ones that are hard to address, you see. Can I move forward? Because I'm already running over time. So we have some choices here, don't we? We've got to make some choices. Firstly, this is our primary choice, isn't it? We need to place before ourselves this primary choice. What are we going to do? What choices are we going to make there? Now, we then can make some decisions about that. And now, in your outline, you'll notice that there are, right near the end, there's a series of things that you can do. So what I'd like you to do is revise your outline. Under using my will to love will mean, there's a whole section in there of what it will mean to you. You follow? From this recognizing the choice,
recognizing which one of these things I'm really currently doing. Which one of these three things am I doing really at this stage? Right? So you can see in the example with Jen just now, you are actually growing your will to sin in that question you were asking me. Right in the moment you were doing it. To feed the addiction, therefore growing your will to sin. While at the same time asking me about not growing your will to sin, but rather growing your will to become more perfect. So you can see how tricky we are, right? Very tricky. Then if you look at over the page, we've got to decide, okay, this is our best option. That's our best option. But will we do it? Will we do it is the question. That's your will being, that's the aspiration that needs to develop. Will you take that option? Every moment that you've got where you can make a decision, will you take that option? That's a good question, isn't it? Because it's the best option, but without us choosing to take it, it's just not going to happen. So the question is, will I take that option? And then what will have to change if I take this option? Well, my behaviour is going to have to change. So an example, if I can use the example, Jen, if that's all right, because it's a great example. So Jen's behaviour will need to change in that she's got to stop feeding addictions while she asks questions. Do you understand? Many of you do this. You're feeding an addiction while you're asking a question. That's a behavioural change. That's a behaviour you've engaged, feeding an addiction, that will have to change. So the very first thing, before I put my hand up, I go, am I just feeding addiction here? Or... And is this a real sincere question? Or am I feeding another addiction by asking this question about another thing, a different related thing, unrelated thing? What am I doing? Right? This is where behaviour is going to have to change. And then I'm going to have to change myself, aren't I? We're going to have to look at, right, how am I going to change myself? Well, obviously, as God's love changes me, things will change quite rapidly. But if I'm not yet in the state where I'm receiving things from God, receiving the truth from God or receiving God's love, then obviously I am going to have to motivate those first changes, aren't I? My will is going to have to be engaged before God can respond to my exercise of my will. So it's no good waiting for God to modify your will for you. You're the person who has control over that process. You're the only person that can make this decision to change the exercise of your own will. Right? Then I'll have to change things about my life. I have to be prepared to actually engage a process where I'm prepared for my life to change. And whatever fears I have and whatever justifications I have for keeping it the same, I'm willing to put those away in the desire to have the bigger rewards that come from engaging my will to love. Right. So you can see that my will to love is really dependent primarily on myself. Now, I can be inspired, people can inspire me, but in the end, unless I have an aspiration that begins from within myself, no amount of inspiration is going to cause my will to change. I am the person who needs to make the decision to change my will, and I am going to have to take action to do that. And I have to do that before I can get educated in love. Not afterwards. It won't happen afterwards. It's before. I've got to engage my will beforehand. Even to receive God's love, your will has to be engaged. To receive God's truth, your will has to be engaged. To make choices and decisions to change your life, your will has to be engaged. And it has to come from within your heart, that you must want it inside of yourself. And if you don't want to, and you recognize you don't want to, even that can be changed as long as you develop an aspiration to change it. Right, but at some point, I'm going to have to take responsibility for that process. No one else can do that for me. God will not do it for you.
God's already given you the gift. God will not tell you how to use it. God is waiting for you to make the decision of how you want to use it for yourself. Make sense? So this is the power of your will. This is the decision that is before you. What are you going to choose to do? That's the real question, isn't it? What are you going to choose to do? Are you going to choose to grow your aspirations to love? Or are you going to, you know, so you're going to do this, grow your aspiration to love? Or are you going to do this, grow or continue growing your aspiration to sin? Or are you going to just decide that nothing's the best option, knowing that in the end, even though you're not growing anything, you're actually probably still degrading? What are you going to choose to do? And are you going to take the steps necessary in your personal life to actually build an aspiration that comes from within yourself, that is not reliant on anyone around you, not reliant on your wife, your husband, your partner, your friend, your God, Jesus, or anybody else, but actually comes from within yourself? And that's the decision you face. So what we'll do is have a 10-minute break now. So if you come back at 12:20, and we'll have a Q&A on that subject.